Hi. Good morning. It's early. Okay, so I got confessions. Are you ready? We're gonna confess. It's a church, or it used to be. Here's the deal. This slide deck is beautiful, and inside this slide deck is our embedded terminal windows that actually work in containers on my Mac, and I have a whole live demo, and it's dope. And not a single one of you are gonna be able to read it. And so here's what we're gonna do. I'm gonna use the first 8-ish slides in this deck, and then what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna talk to you. We're just gonna talk. We're gonna have a conversation. And so I require two things from you, DevOps Days Salt Lake City, to assist me in this endeavor. So thing one is, if you're back there, you should come up here so that you could talk to me easier, because otherwise I'm gonna like just flounder up here like a fish for 45 minutes, and you're gonna be like, oh my God, the chef guy was awful. And it won't be my fault, it'll be yours. Okay, so you don't want it to be your fault, right? These guys came. What's up, guys? These brave dudes are coming up. Those guys are coming up, that's what I'm talking about, right? Okay, so I'm Adam, I'm the CTO chef. But that's like sort of what I play on TV. The truth is I'm a systems administrator. I have been since I was like 17, was my first job. I'm 40-ish now, right? So there you go, math. And one of the things that I have done is I wrote Chef originally, and that was about 8 years ago. And so over the course of the last 8 years, one of the things we've been able to do is go out and see a ton of different people who work in all sorts of different organizations, right? We've seen people who I've got to spend time with like John Esser when he was at Ancestry.com. I've got to go to Facebook. I've got to see how giant banks are run. I was in South Africa, and I've been to a bunch of different places, and I've seen a lot of things. And one of the things that most has been true, especially in the last couple of years, is that we're in the middle of this huge transition, which should be no surprise to you guys, from the way that we used to run our organizations and our companies, where we built enterprises and we had silos and we did the things we did, to a world where all the organizations we have to be designed to allow us to move quickly, right? And to allow us to really create the organizations that can get software out to our customers faster. It's a DevOps Days. So step one to doing that is really understanding what the order is that we need in order to make our own organizations better. So if we want to get better at running our organizations and doing the software that we do, there's really three things we have to do. So the first thing is we have to start with the human beings who do the work. So it starts with us. And the thing about people is that when people are happy and they're having fun and they're engaged in their work, they have a shot at building products that other people like. So a simple way to say that is that sad people build sad products and happy people build happy products. And there's really no exception. So like everywhere I've ever been, I've never seen a team that was miserable that cranked out something amazing. It just doesn't work that way. If you're miserable, your results probably miserable, right? Because you go home at night and you're like, I don't want to do any more work. This was awful. My day sucked, right? But if you're stoked, like you think about it and you want to do better and you put yourself and your heart into it and you have a shot at building a great product. So if you get the people right, and those people feel good, and the team feels right, and it's pulling together, they have a shot at building a great product. And if you build a great product, you have a shot at building a great company. And that's true whether your company exists. If you work for GE, and you know your company's been around since Thomas Edison, it's just as true as it is if you're a tiny startup and you're doing basic things. And so if we want to start with those people, what are the two things that we do for human beings? And basically, one thing is culture, right? And culture's a little fuzzy, but what we really mean when we talk about culture is we're talking about the way people relate to each other, right? And the other thing you have to change is your technology. So culture and technology form this virtuous circle, right? Where the way we behave to each other is reinforced by the technology that we use in our daily lives, right? So if you want to go faster, if you want to do DevOps, but your entire production deployment process is super slow and siloed and has a bunch of technology that is designed around keeping you slow, you can want DevOps all day. If you don't change the way the technology works, you'll just be sad, right? Because the outcomes won't be right. So you have to change both the culture and the technology sort of at the same time. And one of the questions that we've heard a lot over the last 8 years is, what precisely is it that I need to change, right? Like, what exactly is it, what's the technology part of that loop? Because how many people here, when you think about DevOps, don't want DevOps, or you don't want the things that it gives you, right? Hopefully you're here because you think it's a good idea already, so it's sort of a layup to ask that question. But the reality is, when you go into these large companies, when you go out into the world, it's not like they're sitting there to themselves being like, yeah, you know what, I don't want to be more collaborative with other people. I don't really want to be on a high-functioning team that works across the product and build things that are awesome. Like, no one does that, right? But it's the technology that trips us up. And over a couple of years, I think you can really distill it down to this. We need to optimize the way that we build, deploy, and manage software. And that's really it on the technology side. And there's a bunch of things underneath that. There's a lot of work you have to do to make that happen. But if we really think about what's the technology changes we're going through that mirror these cultural changes, it's really all the stuff we're doing around how we build software, how we deploy it, and how we manage it through its life cycle. So one of the things that I do for a living is I build tools, right? So I built Chef. I work with other people, and I talk to people all the time who build Chef. We have dudes from Salt and Pivotal, and this isn't just Chef that thinks this way. This is the whole industry. Like, every vendor who's working on DevOps is thinking about how to solve this build, deploy, manage problem for you, right? And one of the things I realized about a year ago, I was on vacation. I took a month off, which is a thing you can do when your company's 8 years old. And you have 280 people, you get to take a month off. So cheers. I took a month off. I was in Mexico. Anybody been to Mexico? You guys like Mexico? You guys are a quiet crowd. Give it up for Mexico. Yeah. Now we're DevOps dang. All right, so I was in Mexico, right? And I'd been there for a month. And has anybody ever stayed at like a resort that's all inclusive where they like put the wristband on you and you get like everything you want and just shows up? I had never done that. I thought I was a person that wouldn't do that. And then I had kids. And then I was like, oh, I get it now. Like, my kid's off like water skiing. And so my kid had been like playing and being run ragged for a week, right? And it was awesome. And I had spent like a week with my wife alone on a beach. It was amazing. And I was smoking a cigar and drinking tequila by myself on a porch, like while the sun was going down. And I was like, man, you know, like, I've seen this build, deploy, manage problem everywhere. Like, everywhere I go, I see this thing. And we have this, as an industry, like, we have the enterprise's point of view, and then we have the big web's point of view, but every time we try to fix it, it's just brutally hard. Like, it's easy enough to explain sometimes, but when you think about the work you have to put in, like, the effort and the difficulty that's required to really both wrap your head around the scope of the problem and then to implement the technology end-to-end and then also to fix your culture, it was a little disheartening, honestly. And so I was on vacation after, you know, 7 years or whatever of doing this, and I was like, is this as good as it's ever going to get? Like, is there never going to be... Is this difficulty just inherent in the problem? And is there no way out? And so I started thinking about, like, I don't know, maybe there is a way out. Like, I've had a good week, and I've got some tequila and a cigar, and, like, what would we do? And so I started thinking about what we would do. And the first thing I started thinking about was why it was so hard to solve this problem. And so I started thinking about the enterprises that I'd seen. And they all kind of look like this. So in the enterprise, you have some infrastructure, and you don't have just like one piece of infrastructure. You have a lot of infrastructure. So you have like multiple vendors that you buy hardware from for different kinds of things, and you have virtualization platforms, and you have cloud providers, and you have multiple operating systems, and then now you have all these runtime layers you're putting on top of it. You have Pivotal, and you have Mesosphere, and Kubernetes, and you have OpenShift, and you have Docker, and you have all this stuff that's sort of riding on top of that infrastructure, which some things are using, some things aren't. And then you have all these silos for where all the people are working, right? So you have like, I'm a security person, or I'm a software developer, or I'm a QA person, or I'm a systems administrator, right? And then through all of that, we're trying to push applications through that lifecycle, right? So theoretically, on the left, we start doing some work, we do some development, and then we like write the software, and then it like goes to the next silo, and then it like sort of trips its way through. But the truth is, it doesn't go in a line. It's like bounces around all the time. It's all jiggery and weird, right? And And so when we design software for the enterprise, I'm just gonna overshare. Can I overshare? Is it cool to overshare? So OpenStack, right? OpenStack is awesome because it works. Like, that it works at all is amazing. So let's give it up to OpenStack, because that's hard. But there's this feature in OpenStack, which is chargeback billing. And so I was sitting here, and I was drinking tequila and smoking this cigar, and I was thinking about this enterprise problem. And I'm like, you know what the problem with the enterprise is? OpenStack was built for the enterprise. They were like, we are going to give private cloud to the enterprise. And what happened was they went to the enterprise, and they asked the enterprise. They said, enterprise, what do you need in a private cloud? And the enterprise said, chargeback billing. So raise your hand if you know what chargeback billing is. How many of you actually do chargeback billing? One person, right? I'm so sorry. But I'll tell you what, man, there are tens of thousands of lines of code doing chargeback billing. No one turned it on. They wasted so much energy and effort, and it's super deep embedded into that. It gets hard to do. It's this really difficult feature, and everyone told them to want it, and no one runs it. And the reason is that they went and talked to someone in some silo, and they built a product around it. And the problem is, when we design products from this point of view, two things happen. So one, we design for the silo, right? So we pick a silo, configuration management. I sell the systems administrators, and I build a product just for them. And what you can never, ever do, never, ever, is build a product for more than one silo. If you build a product for more than one silo, one of those silos will be like, nah, no, 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 no. You can't bring that application. This, we own application deployment, you see. Those dudes, they do systems administration, so you can sell infrastructure software to them, but don't talk about app deployment. That would be no bueno, right? So from a product design point of view, from thinking about how we solve this build, deploy, manage problem, the first thing we run into is everyone tells you to stay in your box, right? We have this huge problem. It's not an isolated problem. It's a crazy problem that spans the whole company, but we're not even allowed to think about it, right? Because literally, if you start to think about it in the whole, everyone comes to you and is like, that's dumb. Don't do it. Especially your sales reps, because they'll be like, this is so confusing and we're never gonna make any money. And if your tool vendors don't make any money, then the company goes away, and then you're like, open source was awesome. Where were the people that were maintaining that? And then they're all gone, and it's a bummer. And so what happens to you first, you design for the silo. What happens second is you get brave. So you see this a lot, where you go to these companies and you see them, and people do build tooling that crosses those silos. They use Go, right? Or they use Jenkins, or they use whatever, and you build a bunch of glue, and you cobble together all this software and all these runtimes and all this infrastructure and all this stuff, and you build this like crazy Rube Goldberg machine that, like, when you hit the button, it like flips the marble, and then it deploys the software, and then it works. And it's cool, but the problem is, as a product design thing, if we're thinking about how to make it easier to solve the problem, you're forced to integrate with every silo. The reason that it's a Rube Goldberg machine is that there's some person somewhere who bought some piece of software in some silo, and they're like, no, 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 this way, or never, right? And it doesn't matter if it's good or bad. It's just the decision they made, and they own it, and you eat it, right? And so, From a problem-solving point of view, we have this massive issue we have to solve in the industry. We have to all get better collectively at building, deploying, and managing our software. But our very structure, for most of us in the companies we work in, fights against us, both internally in like how we build that process, but also it fights against the tool builders who want to help you because we're forced to make all these concessions to things that we don't really understand. And those concessions happen mentally. Like it's like chains that sort of weigh down your point of view when you think about how to design a solution to a problem. And so it's natural to be like, okay, great, the enterprise is a dead end. Like, if it's so awful in the enterprise, let's just not even think about the enterprise. Like, oof, those dudes are dumb, it's old and busted, they're the legacy, right? So I hate the word legacy, so it's confessional. Remember, I'm only doing the first 8 slides. It's a very different talk than it was supposed to be. So here's the thing about legacy software. Every time you call something legacy, what you mean is the software that runs the planet. That's what you mean. So when you're like, I hate SAP, you're like, really? You hate SAP? That's cool. You let me know when the pivotal enabled SAP replacement is coming along. Someone's writing it, don't get me wrong. Someone's writing it. Someone's like, we are the Cloud Foundry enabled SAP. Like, no question. Also, SAP runs the planet, the whole planet. Not just like Google or Facebook or whatever, all the things. Your bank, SAP core banking, right? Insurance company, SAP core insurance, right? But you know, legacy software, we should just replace it all because it's crap. Except it runs the planet. Okay, maybe we replace it all, but seriously, that's our best plan? That's what we got? Like, as an industry, our big plan is to just say that it's all crap. Everything we've ever done for 20 years is the worst thing you've ever seen, and we're just gonna replace it all because management. Ugh. Okay. Right? Seriously. Okay, so then you go over here and you're like, great, I'm gonna stop being in the big web. The big web, I'm gonna go to the big web because the big web is where the hotness is, right? This is where the cool kids kick it. This is where like Google and Facebook and Twitter and Netflix, and then Netflix is like no ops in, and they're doing all this streaming stuff and it's cool. And you're like, obviously the solution to our problem lives here. We can find it here in the big web. And in a way you can, because they did solve the build and deploy and management problem. They did. And they solved it by building a platform for themselves, right? Every single one of them built a platform. And the platform works basically like this. They standardized their infrastructure, right? So they took away your choice at the bottom layer. And then they built a runtime on top of it, right? That handles orchestration and a bunch of other things. And then they took their operations people and they laid them on top of that. And then they have software developers that build software as it goes sort of through the company. And this works, man. Amazon ships, what, hundreds of times every second, right? And Google can do all kinds of crazy things, and it's amazing. And so it's natural to look at this and be like, great, we have a template. If we could just take all the enterprises in the world and we could make them work like the big web works, then we could solve this build, deploy, manage problem. And if we're gonna do it, what we have to do is two things, what this design tells you, is we have to standardize the infrastructure, so we have to take away your choice about what's happening at the low level, and then we have to give you a standard runtime that you target that you can never deviate from. And if you do those two things, you too can move at the speed of Facebook and Google and Netflix and LinkedIn. But there's a catch. And the catch is this. Facebook and Google and LinkedIn and all those people knew when they started that they were building Facebook and Google and LinkedIn and Netflix. And if you are, say, you know, if you run a bank, you might be 200 years old, right? You don't have the luxury. And by the way, you bought the software that runs the bank. You don't have software developers who are like, oh yeah, man, we crushed the bank building problem. That didn't happen that way. And it's not because you're not smart enough to write the software that runs the bank. Of course you are. It's just that banking isn't, like, you didn't need it. And so these companies knew in the beginning, they were like, I am Facebook, I will write Facebook. But then the next thing that they did was they turned that platform for these companies is their product. What is Netflix without the platform that runs Netflix? It's nothing. What's Google without Google's infrastructure to power the Google search engine? It's nothing. But I'll tell you what, a bank without an infrastructure platform is still a bank. And you can still bank there. And people have been banking there for hundreds of years. So it's weird that our best solution to the design problem is that we're just gonna toss out everything we've ever known about how to run all of these industries and all of that knowledge and all of that software, and we're just gonna kick it out the window in order to get these platforms together. And it was hard. And so I was like, man, oof. I was feeling pretty bad as I was sipping my tequila and smoking my cigar. And I was like, man, I have Chef, and that's good, because I can do anything I want with Chef, because it's just a programming language. And so I can go into all these companies and I can help you. I can just teach you how to build the Rube Goldberg machine, and some number of you will be successful, right? And some number of you won't, but God bless you all, you'll all pay me. So maybe I don't care. And then I was like, no, I care. Because I'm a systems administrator, and this is awful, and I'm a tool builder, and I've got this tequila and this cigar, and I'm feeling good, and I've been on a month vacation, so like I'm feeling kind of chuffed. Like I'm ready, I'm recharged. And so I was like, no, we should solve it. We should make it better. Maybe what we need, what do we need? What should we do? And so I started thinking about when it gets hard. So when precisely is it that the bad times come when we start trying to build this software? And I came up with this. So this is what I call the production cliff. And this is basically the pattern for everyone who decides that what we're gonna do is automate our infrastructure. So you pick a tool, any tool. I'm gonna use Chef because then nobody can say I made fun of someone else's tool on stage. But for the record, you could do any tool you want, right? You wanna put Chef in here, you wanna put Docker up in here, the Salt Stack dudes are here, Pivotal guy, what's up? Doesn't matter what the tool is, we all do this. Here's what happens. You start out the first time and you're like, whoa, this is gonna change everything, right? And it's because it's easy. That first time you type Docker run, right? You type Docker run IT, a piece of software, you hit enter and you're like, yes! The future has arrived, right? And so you start using it, right? And it gets a little harder, just a little, not a lot. And it just keeps getting a little harder and harder and harder, and you're learning more, and you're investing your time, and you're into the tool, and you kind of fall in love. Like, you start to have a relationship, and you're like, yeah, you know, Chef's my homie, right? Like that's my Huckleberry right over there. I'm into it. And then you reach what I call the peak of false hope, and that's that little top of the rise there. The peak of false hope is the moment where you're like halfway to putting that technology all the way into production, right? And you think that you know everything there is to know about how that thing's gonna work and how you should design it. And you're like, I got this, right? And you have this glorious moment where the dip goes down and you're like, yeah, I am chefing, right? Or like, yeah, I'm cloud foundrying or you're dockering or whatever the thing is. And you're like, I got this. And then it goes through the stratosphere in difficulty. It's just like, no, bam. It's like somebody came to your house with a board and had nails in it and was just like, no, you cannot have nice things, right? And they just like snuck in at night, right? You were like, but it was gonna work. And then it was like, no. And next thing you know, you spent another month and it was awful. But like, and the Rube Goldberg machine comes together. You climb the mountain. You know what I'm saying? Like, you get over the hump. It's not like you stop. You don't. You push through it. And you get to the top and you're like, yes, I love this technology. Because you forgot about the part where it hits you in the face like a board full of nails for months. Because it solved your problem, sort of. And because you emotionally get invested in the difficulty level, that it was hard is part of why it was good. Like, we like to do things that are hard because we get to conquer them, you know? Like, we overcome. And so this production cliff is part of the problem because it teaches us that what we should have is things that are difficult. So look, when I say, there's an important thing here. I'm not saying that your problems should stop being complicated. It's complicated, right? You run, it's complicated, it's hard, it's complex. It doesn't have to be difficult, as hard as it is. And so my question then was, okay, if we really wanted to solve this problem, forget about the enterprise's point of view, forget about the big web's point of view, what would we do if we wanted to flatten out the curve, right? What if we wanted to build something that would let you solve the build and deploy and management problem, but the curve stays flat, right? Where as you get closer to production, it doesn't get more difficult and it doesn't get harder. What would that be? And so I was drinking tequila and I had this thought and I was like, what would it do? And my first thought was, nah, I don't think you can do it. I don't know if that would work. And then I was like, well, we built this thing a couple years ago called Omnibus. Anybody know what Omnibus is? Some people in the crowd know Omnibus? Omnibus basically just takes your software and all the things that it needs and puts them in a giant tarball. And we wrote it because operating systems move too slow and they're awful. And so I would be like, man, I need a new version of OpenSSL, and Red Hat would be like, nope. Or like I would need some library and it wouldn't have it and you wouldn't have it and then somebody like would pay me to like run on SUSE Linux and it would be the wrong dep and it was awful. So we built this thing called Omnibus, and Omnibus works, which is awesome, but it was a little complicated. And what we got to was, you know what, we need something that really understands how to move through this cycle. And what we came up with was a thing we call Habitat. I launched Habitat yesterday. Thank you. And there's a recording of what, from here on, if I was going to keep going, I'm going to keep going, but in a minute there'll be a bunch of terminal windows that you're not going to get to see. So if you want to see what the terminal windows would have been, you can go watch this other presentation, or we can give you one over there. I have 5 minutes left. I'm crushing it right now. So we launched this thing, we called it Habitat, and here's what Habitat does for you. We started to think about the application problem differently. What we said was this. We said, rather than thinking about our problem as infrastructure, so if you think about automation, we've all thought about it as infrastructure. The application team writes the app. Other people, operations people, automate around the application. We come in later and we try to build a platform or we try to write scripts or we try to do whatever, but it all happens around the application. It's like a big side effect. Developers do whatever and then we figure out a way to twist what they've done and put it in production. And Habitat flips that over and says, what if we thought about everything not from the infrastructure's point of view, but instead from the applications? What if the application itself was responsible for the entirety of its behavior from build through to deploy through to management? What would be different? And the big aha moment was this. All the automation has to travel with the application itself. So rather than saying that there's a platform that provides orchestration, or provides service discovery, or provides topology or deployment orchestration, simply deploying the application should deploy service discovery. It should deploy the topology. It should deploy the update strategy. And if that happened, a huge part of the difficulty curve could go away. Because if you look at what gets hard, using Docker is not hard. Docker gets hard when we have to do service discovery, embedded monitoring. We have to do complex topologies. We have to do leader followers for databases. We have to, like, all of that stuff is where it gets, is where it really gets worse. And so Habitat takes that stuff and it rolls it up inside the application itself with two pieces. So one is a build system that looks a little like, anybody use Arch Linux? And okay, what's up, my Arch Linux people? How about Nix? People know what Nix is? Nix is a purely functional package manager. So it's like Arch Linux and Nix had a baby. So it's got, it's like Arch's format, and then it has Nix's side benefit, which is that the packages are atomic and immutable. And then there's a supervisor, and that supervisor runs your services, and the supervisor is very smart, so it can connect to other supervisors, and it does all the coordination of service discovery and deployment and a bunch of other things. And you can take these Habitat packages, and you can deploy them on top of the infrastructure platform of your choice. So if the right place to deploy your application is Pivotal, deploy it on Pivotal. If the right place to put it is on physical gear, you can put it on physical gear. So we can wrap, for example, SAP Core Banking in Habitat. And then you can manage SAP Core Banking the way you manage your applications that run on Pivotal without having to have two different management philosophies. You're free to choose the infrastructure that makes sense, which means we can actually decide if all the software that runs the world is actually bad software. We don't have to throw it away just so we can manage it well. And so, that's my talk. And if you have more questions, I would love to answer them later on when we have more time. I have 3 more minutes. Somebody have a question? It was weird to give a talk that was supposed to have a demo that didn't. But what's up? Somebody have a question? No questions? I dropped this whole thing and it was all random and strange and nobody's like, I'm confused. You wanna see it? Of course you do. Yeah, so do I. Here, watch this. Starts with plans, they're declarative, let's do this. I'm gonna build Redis in a leader follower topology really fast. In 2 minutes or less. Can I do it? Only if I can see my mouse. Come on. Come on, mousey mouse. There you are. You gotta come down here, do that too. That's a terminal, in case you can't see it. Hey guy. Okay, let's try it. So what I just typed was, I just typed hab start core Redis topology leader. And it went out and it downloaded Redis and all of its friends. Thanks, dude. And all of its dependencies, and started itself up. And now what we're gonna do, you can't see it, but trust me, that totally just happened. And so, we're gonna do, you see why I ad-libbed? Okay, hang on. Scroll up, little man. Oh, you don't have to. Okay, can I do it? Yeah. Who's got victory? I have victory. Okay, here's what we're gonna do. So we're gonna do it again. Hab start core Redis topology leader. And we're gonna say peer to the other guy. So we have one service in Windows, so that's like a Linux box, and now we're gonna join another Linux box to that guy, and it's gonna block. So it installed Redis, and now it's like, yo, that's cool. Now I'm waiting for one more thing. And then we're gonna launch one more of these windows. Come on, guy. You got this.
They said 30 seconds. Hab, start, core, Redis, topology, leader, your peer is that guy. Go, baby.
Now it's starting an election. It elected a leader. And now there are, so what just happened was service discovery, leader election, and it automatically configured Redis to do leader follower, and it'll route writes through one Redis cluster to another. And we did that without deploying a single external service in a web browser by starting the application. That's Habitat. It'll also update itself. It'll also do secure, if you've ever used Vault and do like secure secrets management, it does that for you too. And it does it all with a gossip ring. So as you deploy more of those things, it gets more available and more stable. And it'll work for the legacy hardware you have, legacy apps. It'll also work when you deploy it on Pivotal. Habitat's dope, and you should check it out. Thanks.
One of the things that I have learned that is so important that I believed was true, and then it wasn't until I got the chance to help build Habitat that I learned for real, was that Deming quote is legit. There it goes. So yeah, that Deming quote's legit, and one of the reasons it's legit is that, one of the reasons it's legit is that the most important thing for teams is context. And so when you give someone, people talk about like key measures and objective results and all that things, and one of the things I don't like about them is that they take away context from people. They hand you a metric so that you don't have to ask questions. And then if you don't ask questions, you don't know the context, you don't know the context, then you're just waiting for someone to spoon feed you the answers, and it's sort of a bummer. Does anybody have a question for me? Yeah, how does Chef and Habitat fit together? So maybe you could read that, if I can make it even bigger. Maybe? Maybe if I'm, anyway, maybe we'll do some more terminal magic if you want to see more Habitat. But it fits together, so Habitat thinks about the world from the application's point of view. So when the talk I was trying to give you was called Evolution of Automation, and what I was trying to get at was that there's sort of two layers of abstraction. So one is the generic can do whatever you need abstraction, and that's pretty much Chef. Like, people can do anything they want with Chef. It's pretty flexible. It works great at the infrastructure level. And you're going to have plenty of infrastructure that needs to be managed. And so using Chef to manage it makes good sense. Habitat thinks about the world from the application's point of view, and it says that all of the automation that we would have done to support the application's lifecycle from the beginning to the end, so deployment, management, security, topologies, update strategies, service discovery, distributing secrets, all that stuff, actually the application, when you deploy the application, you should also be deploying all of the supporting infrastructure for all of your applications at the same time. And it does that through having the supervisor, so there's a thing that runs the services you declare when you build a Habitat package. That supervisor is smart and it gossips around. And so it handles the application piece. So Chef and Habitat go together sort of peanut butter and jelly-y, because if you look at where Chef gets hard when you start trying to do all the complicated application automation and behavior stuff. Like, that's where Chef gets really difficult. Has anybody tried to do that with Chef? Like, automate all your application lifecycle? It's hard. You can do it, but it sucks a little, if we're being honest with ourselves. And Habitat doesn't suck to do that. It feels great. So Habitat's great at the application level. Chef's great at the infrastructure level. I don't know. Can we just get super nerdy? Okay, let's do some distributed systems nerdery, yeah? I totally want, like, I'm dying to talk about it, so if you guys want to go, like, all the way to the bottom, let's do it. So basically, here's what happened. So who's used etcd and console? Okay, me too, and they're cool. And what's neat about etcd and console is you can build stuff on top of them, right? So they work, console in particular, has a gossip layer, right? So Surf does some gossip, and then on top of it, they do a thing called Raft, which is a consensus protocol. And they're doing that because what they're providing to you is basically an API to setting key value pairs. It's like a distributed database. And it gives you some guarantees about ordering and about when things get set. And so when you do something like, for example, leader election or service discovery, what you're doing is actually writing it into this database in the sky that makes these guarantees about timing. And that's cool because it can work and it's generic and it's really easy to reason about as a developer, because you're just like, write a key, and it's like, I did. And then you're like, you know, is that key the one I think it is? And it's like, it is, and everything's pretty easy. One of the things that we discovered with Habitat, though, was any time that we introduced variability in behavior, we were breaking that idempotency promise. So So that convergent, repeatable sort of autonomous actor behavior. So the original prototypes of Habitat, the way we built it, we had a working prototype like 2 weeks in. And then we've been refining that prototype for a year, basically. And one of the reasons it took us so long was that we started out using etcd for service discovery, and the plan was that we were going to have multiple backends, right? The difficulty is that etcd, Zookeeper, and console all behave differently. So like the details of how they implement that and how they decide what's right or what's wrong, they're different. And so what was going to happen if we kept it was you were going to wind up having Habitat applications that behave differently. So it would be like, this package, if you're using etcd, works like this. This package, if you're using Zookeeper, well, it's a little different. This package, if you're using console, not quite the same. And that felt awful as a user experience. The other problem was you had to deploy etcd, and I had to deploy console, and I had to learn how to manage that thing at scale across multiple data centers and all this stuff. And it was its own distributed system, and it was part of the difficulty curve. So I was showing Habitat to Microsoft, and there's a guy named John Gossman. Does anybody know John Gossman? John is very, very smart, and John saw that part of the demo, and he was like, that part feels not so good. And I was like, yeah, right? I'm super worried about it because, you know, all the things I just said. And he was like, why don't you just write your own gossip layer? And I was like, isn't that hard? And he was like, dude, it's not that hard. Like, you're smart. And I was like, no, that's a terrible idea. Like, I'd have to rebuild like Raft or Paxos. And he was like, I don't know, would you? And I was like, yeah. And then I left Microsoft. I went home. And I was like, would I? I was like, what do I actually need? Like, what do the services need? Do they need to be strongly consistent? And I was like, no. No, they super don't. Like they come up whenever they do, and they do whatever, but like, if it was fast-ish, it'd be fine. And I was like, how fast does fast-ish have to be? And it was like, I don't know, like 30 seconds? Like, if I could just do it in 30 seconds, would it be cool? And it was like, yeah. And so then I started being like, reading papers. So I went back to like the papers from like the 70s. This is a long answer, but hey, you wanted to be nerdy. You told me to. So I started reading these papers from the 70s that were like where all the gossip protocols came from, and reading my way up so I could like understand what was going on, because I was terrified. I was like, you're not supposed to write your own distributed systems. It's like cryptography. And what I learned was that basically we could build a gossip system that does sort of two things, so or has a couple of things sort of nested together. So the first part is we don't need strong consistency. We're happy with weak consistency. And the reason is that each actor is actually autonomous, which means we can't guarantee the universal state of the cluster anyway. So there's always gonna be some variability in timing. So we don't need the strong consistency guarantee, partly because it's not user serviceable. So you don't take Habitat's supervisor and the gossip ring it uses and talk to it. It's just for Habitat. Like you can't like write your own stuff to it, right? And the protocol on the wire basically is SWIM. So SWIM is a way of doing service, basically failure discovery. So you get a list of peers and you're like, and we join together and you share with me your list and I share with you mine, and we occasionally walk around in a circle and are just like, are you still alive? Is everything cool? And then inside of that, you piggyback. You can piggyback other messages. And so there's another gossip thing called newscast that basically talks about how in a system that eventually stays stable, so if your distributed system gets big enough and stays stable, then eventually all the gossip data, all the things you want to share, will eventually get everywhere. I don't know when. Like, I can't guarantee when they'll get there, but I guarantee they'll arrive. So SWIM is doing this, like, sin, act, sin kind of thing, where it's like, are you alive? Yes. And we trade our data. And so we have this list of rumors, news. We call them rumors, but if you read the newscast paper, they call it news. And you pass your news, but only the hot news. So basically, you only pass the news that you've never shared before. So if you've never told me the secret or the rumor, you will tell me. You'll be like, oh, you haven't heard about the unicorn being soft and fluffy? And she'll be like, oh, I totally heard it. And I'm like, I don't tell her again, but that dude, you haven't heard about the unicorn soft and fluffy. And then you'll be like, oh, I haven't told you about the unicorn being soft and fluffy. And you'll be like, soft and fluffy. And we could like do this right now. Turn to the person next to you and say, the unicorn is soft and fluffy. Now turn to the other person who you didn't talk to and say it again. How many people in the room have been told the unicorn is soft and fluffy? Everybody. How long did it take? No time at all, because it was infectious.
right? Like the ring was like, oh my God, the unicorn's soft and fluffy. Oh my God, the unicorn's soft and fluffy. And so the math says, and we haven't actually done it because it's new and open source, but the math says we should be able to do that at humongous scale if I can get you all to stop being so damn chatty about the whole world, right? And so one of the things we did was we were worried about flooding the network. With all those rumors. And so the wire protocol, so the actual transport, is actually the BitTorrent protocol. It's MuTP. So it's reliable UDP. And we did that because it'll back off in the face of network contention. So basically the gossip network will go as fast as it can, but if anything contends with it, it'll just back off and slow down. So it'll just on the wire back up. And then inside those subprotocols are what are called CM or CVRDTs. And it's a long word, but what it means is that when you design the way that protocol works, so like for example, leader election, what has to happen is you can't guarantee the order of things, so you have to instead guarantee that the protocol will run to completion if all the same messages are received. So the way leader election works is if we were gonna do a leader election with this front row, everybody would raise your hand and say, I am the leader. Now the person with the biggest beard is the actual leader. So when you trade it to the person next to you, you'll be like, is my beard bigger than your beard? And you'll be like, nope. And eventually it'll wind up with that dude being left alone and you'll all be sharing that room and be like, beard guy, leader. And it finishes, it's called bully. It's like the simplest algorithm in the world. And it just runs to completion. And it works because it doesn't matter when they communicate with each other, they'll all eventually get to the point where that dude has the biggest beard and then they all agree and everything's fine and that's how Habitat works. I think we have one more minute, maybe. Three more minutes, maybe. Another question? That was sort of a deep thing. So it replaces, we embed that in the supervisor because it means that when you decide to go to production, what you don't have to do is deploy any other stuff to run your application at all. So there's no service discovery, you don't have to deploy service discovery, you don't have to deploy secrets management, you don't have to do deployment orchestration, you just pass flags to Habitat, yeah? Yeah, why is DevOps important to me? DevOps is important to me because I am a systems administrator. That's what I actually am. I play other things now, but I'm actually a systems administrator. And the most important thing in my career was that when I was on teams where we were working together closely to solve big, hard problems, those were the most awesome moments in my career. And the worst moments in my career were the moments where I had a boss once who's my boss's boss. And he just thought we were all stupid. You know what I mean? Like he literally just thought everyone that worked for him was a chucklehead, and that systems administrators weren't smart enough. He took us to a bar for Systems Administrator Appreciation Day one time, and told us all that we were nice enough, but it would be better if we could be smart enough to be software developers on Systems Administrator Appreciation Day. And so I had this thing where I was like, you know what? I don't like you guys at all. Like, I don't like feeling that way, and I don't like the idea that these people are this class of people who are my enemy. Nor do I like the idea that I, because I like the back end infrastructure part of what I'm doing, am somehow not worthy. And so for me, there's a coinciding of DevOps and the cultural and professional movement that it is with this realization that it takes every single person who's involved in building these organizations, working together to have the outcomes be amazing. And that if we just ask each other, if we simply invite each other to be great, and we invite each other to build things and to work together and to understand each other, that our lives get better, that I never have to have that time where I'm in that bar with someone who says that to me ever again, because I get to be in this room with everybody, all of you, and we get to go build this other thing, and we get to actually be the environment we want. And that same dude, I am certain right now, loves DevOps and is so excited about all the future things he gets to have in the world. And that is why DevOps matters to me.